Okay, so then spike in RNAs is mainly relevant for these full-length methods like SMRT-seq2, because we can't add spike-ins to Drop-seq, for instance, because then you can't make sure to have the same amount in each drop. But what it is basically external molecules that you add in a known concentration per well. One common kit to use is this ERCC spike-in. So it's actually optimized to not be similar to any human and mouse transcripts. They have different concentrations and different lengths. And another kit is called CIRV, which is fairly similar. And the idea is, on one hand, that you should, if you compare these two cells and you only do count normalization, they would look identical, right? You have the same proportions of these three different genes expressed. But if you add in a spike in, you can say something about the relative abundance. Unfortunately, there is no perfect spike in. So basically, there is a clear bias. These are shorter mRNAs, and they get amplified better. So if you compare the real transcriptome to the spike in, it's not a perfect representation. But you can still use the spike in to estimate the amount of RNA you had to start with. And also use it to model technical noise between. So that's one common way of detecting, predicting variable genes, is to use the spike ins to model technical noise and then say that the biological genes are what's over this technical noise boundary. I think it's also good, just as a quality control, to have them there. Either you have a library prep where you don't even amplify the spike-ins, then you know that it completely failed. Or if 90% of your reads are spike-in, then you know that you didn't have a lot of cell RNA in that well.